Welcome to tonight's program, Student and Community Divestment Protests in the 1980s. My name is Anka Voss, and I'm the Director of the Archives and Special Collections here at the Urbana Library. And if you've never visited the Archives, we are located on the second floor of the library. We're open 7 days a week, and we're established in 1956, and the Archives contains a research level collection on history and genealogy of Champaign County. And it has a diverse array of resources to aid in the research of local history and genealogy. We have databases of international scope and unique collections that document local life from the 1830s to the present. Some exciting recent additions to our collection include the papers of Dr. Ellen Miner, a physician in Champaign from the late 19th century through the early 20th century. Very, very unique collection. That just walked in our door. I mean, usually that's how we get collections. People find things in their grandparents' basements or family basement, and they give us a call and see, do you want this? And again, her collection is very, very unique. We are also currently conducting oral histories with long-term members of the League of Women Voters. We've conducted about half a dozen, and we're starting a oral history project with the Illinois Nurses Association's local chapter, and we have six oral histories scheduled next week. So we're very busy. We also offer events and workshops throughout the year, so please visit us upstairs on the second floor or online. You can follow us on Facebook, although it's the library's website, but our blog and our social media is posted there as well. We are here tonight because in 2014, panel member Jeff Machota contacted me to donate the records of the Progressive Resource Action Cooperative. I also hired, a little later, graduate student Raquel Flores Clemens over there to process this collection and a few samples from that collection, and materials that some of the panelists brought are on this table over here. Anyways, Raquel, over the last months, has processed this collection and is soon going to be open for research. There'll be a finding aid that you can access through our catalog, but it'll be open to the public. And we thank you both for making this possible for this material to be open. The cooperative and the panel will, of course, talk more. The cooperative was a grassroots social justice organization which, of course, fought for many social justice causes and grew out of the local anti-apartheid protest movement, about which we will hear more about tonight. And the Divest Now Coalition and the Champaign Coalition Against Apartheid organized protests and boycotts in the late 70s and throughout the 80s, eventually forcing the University of Illinois to divest funds. And I found in the yearbooks, and Rhonda actually reminded us, there probably is something in the yearbook. There's a little article in the 1987 yearbook stating that fact. So you can see right over there. As we were reviewing current content, and of course the university archives in Ellis Wayne, the archivist for student life at the university is here as well. The university also has important records from the divestment movement in their archives. But other resources that we found, one of the very unique collections that the archives has is we have the print negative archive of the News Gazette here at the archives. And our negatives date from the mid-60s through the present. Now they are in digital form, so again, it's digital content, but it's a print negative archive through 2003, which is when they went digital. We searched the print negative archive for articles that the News Gazette had taken of the divestment movement on campus and found a treasure trove of photographs. Mm-hmm. There are, you know, several hundred. We selected approximately 50 of them and put them on a Flickr page, which you can see through the library's website. And it's here, so afterwards, if you want to take a look, feel free. Also, before I come to you, I did put a sign-up sheet here. And if you have material or stories that you would like to share about the divestment movement or other social justice organizations in Champaign-Urbana, that please let us contact you for donating materials or participating in an oral history project. Okay, so please put down your name. But at this point, please welcome our panel members, Jeff Machota and Bryan Savage and Lisa Dixon and Rhonda Kirts. And the four of them will introduce themselves and will lead our discussion. And thank you so much for participating. Very grateful.
So I'll start. We're just briefly going to introduce ourselves and who we were back then and who we are now. So I came down here in 1984 to go to school. I got involved in the sanctuary movement, which was for providing sanctuary for El Salvadoran refugees. Out of that, I got connected with a student government slate called Off Center, which was a progressive slate. And that slate ended up winning the majority in student government. And one of the planks of that slate was divestment from South Africa. So and we can get into that more later. From that, I helped form the Divest Now Coalition, which was a committee of the Champaign-Urbana Coalition Against Apartheid. And I helped put out an alternative report on divestment, which is sitting over there. Did a couple issues of the Divestment Times, a paper. And that was all in 1985. By that summer, I was one of 16 people arrested at a Board of Trustees meeting in Chicago, where I met my lawyer. And by 1986, I was one of the leaders of the movement, and I did everything from helping plan rallies, meetings, shantytowns, marches, direct actions, etc. So for the past 18 years, I've been a bookkeeper for local nonprofits, Champaign County Healthcare Consumers, and Community Shares of Illinois. I also am a national staff member for Vietnam Veterans Against the War, where I put out their newspaper, do the books, maintain a website. And in 2014, I gave a whole bunch of my files over here. And so divestment stuff is just the very tip of the stuff that I donated. There's a lot of stuff on the anti-chief movement, the anti-Gulf War movement, but this was what we're focusing on tonight.
So I've been informed I will speak next. My name is Lisa Dixon. I currently teach in the theater department here at the University of Illinois. I was an undergraduate student in anthropology here, getting my degree in anthropology when I ended up joining the CUCA, the Champaign-Urbana Coalition Against Apartheid. Jeff and I lived in the same residence hall, Allen Hall, which is just a hotbed.
Still is.
That was the reputation. And I got involved and very quickly was put to work doing a lot of, as Jeff said, anything from helping to make flyers, you know, old school style, where you had to go and actually tape them up on something somewhere. And then learning a lot, doing a lot of very deep learning about the situation, learning about, not just about specifically about the situation in South Africa, but also about what it means to be working in a movement and how one has to learn to work in a movement and to work with those folks. As opposed to trying to do something for them, but actually to really learn how to work collaboratively with people on issues. And then moved in that year, I believe in 85, 86, then was moved into being a spokesperson as things started to heat up across campus. And all of that culminated, as Jeff said, with our occupying the union and then occupying the Board of Trustees meeting the next day. And from there forward, I mean, my mother had already been involved in local politics, but I think from there forward, my sort of burgeoning recognition of injustice in the world sort of flowered, and I moved forward in working on other movements like the anti-chief movement, like continuing to work on issues of divestment, but also working on needle exchanges and on AIDS work and working with ACT UP in Ann Arbor, Michigan, and so have been involved in one aspect or another with social justice movements since then for about 30 years, I guess. What I said before, I teach at the University of Illinois, and I think I said that.
Sure.
I'm not.
Okay.
We were the kids, remember that?
I was the adult.
Yeah.
There you go.
So I'm a little bit different than the rest of the group in that I was involved in student government, okay, and I'm from a small town of 250 people in St. Marie, Illinois. So look that up. I was the only one that was born the year that I was born in my town, and I came to the University of Illinois, okay? And I was at the presentation my freshman year where the president of student government spoke, Tom Hesse, do you remember Tom? And he actually went on to be mayor of Malibu. And he said, maybe someday you'll be standing up here and you'll get to give this speech and be president of student government as well. And I had this overwhelming feeling like, I'm gonna do that. Okay, like who did I think I was? So, but I got involved, and what I did in student government was register thousands of people to vote. I went over with Denny Bing and fought with the ladies there to get them to give me voter registration cards. And then I would go to my friends who were in college Republicans, which I was not, and said they would give me hundreds, but the little old ladies would only give me 15 because I was in student government. And then I was a community affairs chair for the university, or for student government, was on the Illinois Board of Higher Education Student Advisory Committee, was involved in the United States Student Association and went to their national conferences, and then ended up running for student government and was a vice president in my junior year, which would have been 84, 85, and decided to run for president, okay? And the off-center group had talked to folks, and they decided I was a fair person, and that I would, and they didn't run a candidate for president, okay? And then we ran in slates, and so I ended up winning, and the treasurer for the off-center group became the treasurer of the SGA, Student Government Association, which was pretty amazing because openly gay male, Larry Osborne, okay? And so, for me, I felt like this was really life-changing and altering in that I was kind of thrust into this, and I saw my role, and we have like how folks were elected there, everyone was elected, and I needed to help everybody be able to accomplish what they were trying to do. So we worked to have Randall Robinson come to the Board of Trustees meeting in June, and that's when people first got arrested, and we weren't planning on doing that, right, Jeff, at all? I still remember being in my little pink dress, going to the Chicago police station, giving my own money to get people out of jail. So we're really planning on doing that. So, we were scared. I was scared for people because we weren't really planning on that. And then we're witnesses at discipline meetings we're going to talk about. And through that, found that facilitating that and helping individuals be able to reach their goals is what I wanted to do. So I became a university administrator, and I ended up here, and I'm actually the advisor to the Illinois Student Center, which is the successor, but not very well, I'll tell you that right now, to the Student Government Association, and I'm working with them to try to get them to change it, but I'm their advisor, and they have to do it, and I was with them there last night till 12:30. Okay, or 11:30, excuse me, because they were upset, and rightfully so, because of the chalking that happened, and there was actually, just for you to know, very disturbing, students dressed up like Muslims and TSA folks and had a party, okay?
What?
Okay, yeah. Okay, now I'll tell you that's not what it appears, and I'll let folks go on, okay? So group of students doing different things. And actually, the students who dress up as Muslim were Muslim, okay? But what on the surface appeared like. So we have a lot of education to do, continuous, as you know. So, but that's what I do. And I've worked on campus for 26 years. So, So go ahead.
Yeah, well, I thought it was right for them to go first because they took all the risks, right? I mean, they were the ones actually doing the demonstrating and putting their educations on the line and so forth. So their stories are more interesting. I, as Jeff pointed out, was the adult in this room. Well, among other adults. There turned out to be seven attorneys working on the case, two of whom are in the audience. So it was Harvey Welch and Marvin Gerstein. So, you know, our, you know, I've seen a lot of protests at this university. So I came in 69-70. So that was the spring of Kent State, and there were National Guard all over the place, and they were beating the living daylights out of people. So, you know, it's always been kind of an interest in mine, of mine. And I know that, you know, starting back with the Vietnam demonstrations, the university wanted to get rid of students who were arrested or broke some other kind of rule in the protest. So there was a real threat, I thought anyway, to these the students who had been arrested. So it's interesting to think about that and then kind of look at today, right? And you see somebody like Lisa, who's actually a professor at the university. That might not have happened had they kicked you out. So, yeah. So. And that's all the credit I'll take for your success.
You get all the rest.
Anyway, so my job was to provide, you know, and the other seven, the other six attorneys, just name them Bill and Susan McGrath and Francis Boyle and Marvin and Harvey and myself and
Steve Beckett,
right. No. Anyway, so our, you know, we provided a kind of innovative legal defense. I think, what were the charges? Criminal trespass to?
Criminal trespass to state property.
State supported property.
And resisting arrest, maybe sometimes if you twitched a little bit. So we decided that, you know, the goals were no criminal record, right? No criminal record. And you can either accomplish that by making a deal for it, maybe where somebody gets what was called supervision and they lead an upstanding life for a year or so, and then the whole thing is dismissed. Or you could defend it, right, and maybe actually win. And you're kind of wondering what's a defense when these people have kind of intentionally done what they did and made no secret about it. And in fact, you know, would like to nothing more than to talk about it in these proceedings. So Francis Boyle, who was, who still is a professor at the law school, had been doing a kind of defense for civil disobedience based on the necessity defense. So necessity is an affirmative defense in Illinois law. So meaning that the defendant has to put on some evidence that, you know, this defense has a factual basis and could raise a reasonable doubt in the jury's mind. So we were going to do that by putting Francis on the stand and asking him about the horrors of apartheid and entering some evidence about it that way. And so the whole defense is, well, okay, I broke the law and, you know, I, you know, with some inconvenience, some damage, you had to start your meeting over again, whatever. But I did that, you know, to try and beat this other huge evil, right? So we thought when it got to a, you know, when it got to a jury, maybe a jury would say, okay, so, you know, not guilty. Anyway, you know, you make the state work a bit, and so maybe you get a better deal if you can't put on that defense. So we did that, and we went to, Harvey could tell you a story, so could Marvin, about the disciplinary hearings and the kind of defenses that were put up at the disciplinary hearings. And the goal was kind of to let the students speak their minds, right? There was one hearing I went to where they decided the best way to speak their minds was to put tape over their mouths and just sit there silently through the whole thing. And that's what they did. And you know, you take advantage of that. You argue the moral high ground, how principled they are, and how much risk they're willing to take. And don't you dare throw them out of school because we'll get you if you do. Something like that. That's the message. Anyway, that's what we did.
All right, so I think what we're going to do now is that was the introduction to ourselves. Is each
that was the whole story.
Is go through and tell a couple other stories. So, I'm trying to gauge the audience here. You can pass these around.
Oh, I love it.
I was assigned to do a brief history of, very brief, before I told a story. So I'm assuming most people here know what apartheid was and the divestment movement. But just so briefly, and this I found this online as a resource. I did not write this. It seems mostly accurate. There seems to be a few errors, but it's okay. So apartheid was set up in 1948 in South Africa. By the 60s, the divestment movement was being pushed by the different liberation forces as a tactic. So for companies and for universities to divest their funds from South Africa. Here locally in 1977, it's when the Champaign-Urbana Coalition Against Apartheid formed, and that was the first time that there was divestment movement on this campus. They did an occupation of the president's office, of U of I, who was Corbelly at the time, did a big sit-in, debated that. That went on. There was a statewide coalition called the Coalition for Illinois Divestment from South Africa, CIDSA. There's a t-shirt over there from them. Prexy Nesbitt was one. They were a labor organization throughout the state. They did a lot of focus on labor and getting governments to divest. KUKA here hooked up with CIDSA and started working on stuff. Things kind of slowed down a little bit. And as Rhonda mentioned, when student government got involved and this group off-center got involved, this was kind of the second or final wave of the divestment movement. So that when the student government helped sponsor a rally, which was the first one in that period, so that was in spring of 85, it was part of some national days of action. So this was happening throughout the entire country, the divestment movement. In 85, there was a board of trustee member, Al Logan. He was the sole voice for divestment. Every meeting he would bring up a resolution and he'd get his own vote. He brought it up at one point when we were at, there was a Divest Now coalition also formed at University of Illinois Chicago. So we had organizations working at both campuses, since there were campuses here and in Springfield. So there was a vote then in June of 85, and they voted no, and that's when 16 of us surrounded the board and got arrested. And just context-wise, at that point, the U of I had an endowment had investments of $131 million, 21 were in South Africa, and the majority of that being IBM and GM. As things went on, and so by 1986, things just blew up. I don't know how I went to class, and actually I realized I didn't. That's how we got things done. So we had, and I'll talk a little bit more about it, but we had multiple shanty towns on the quad. We had the biggest rally on campus since the Kent State protest. We had over 1,000 people show up. We occupied the union. We shut down a board of trustees meeting. We had over 60 people arrested. We didn't stop. We kept on going. We pushed. But that fall, we continued to work on stuff. The pressure was on. The pressure was on internationally as well as nationally. The board of trustees snuck a vote in January of 87. When we weren't in session, and they chose to divest, but they really only divested $3.3 million. They kept everything in IBM and GM through a strategy called fake disinvestment, but it was seen as we did win something, but also it was more or less the end of the movement. So that was the end of the divestment. So that's the little history, and that kind of outlines some of that. What I wanted to talk about briefly, and I brought visual aids as well. I printed out some of the Flickr stuff, though it's just in black and white. So what we did back then, this was a nationwide movement. We didn't create all the tactics that we used. We copied, we adapted, we altered. So we created, what we did, we chose to do was claim the public space of the quad as a place to protest. We had done talks, we had done educationals, we had done all that other stuff. So we did. We created a series of shanty towns, and this was again a tactic that was used at Columbia University, it was used at Berkeley, lots of different places. So the idea was to have direct education, as well as direct action, as well as engage with the university and the administration. And we had And this is where things get a little fuzzy, and I don't think all of us can remember. We had at least three different shanty towns, because we were fighting with the university to keep these up, because this was not allowed. You're allowed to speak on the front of by the union, or the free speech space, which I think has finally been torn down. They used to have a little free speech space that was just one little concrete podium. But so we broke that out. We said we're going to do this in a different place. So I think somewhat probably undemocratically, some of us were, some members of the Divest Now Coalition were drinking at Trino's, which is now long gone, but decided that, hey, what we should do is build a shanty. We're going to take it to Full and Dry Auditorium. We're going to chain it there, and then we'll see what happens. We'll just leave it if they come or whatever. Whatever, there was like five of us. We built it at a place that no longer exists. We built this ramshackle thing at noon.
Many a pitcher of beer has fomented revolution.
So we take this thing, at noon, we chain it to the stairs of Fullinger, and then the media came out, the things came out. By that evening, people were dropping off pallets of wood, and we had built a shanty town that was all the way around the stairs of Fullinger Auditorium.
Oh, right.
The front part.
The patio.
It was open, right?
Yeah, the front was open.
Okay. So we did that, and so what this became was we were out there 24/7. So people would stop by in between classes. People would stay out overnight. We would do direct education. One of the great things was that we'd be passing out leaflets to people and explaining the issue to them, and the next day they were passing out the leaflets to people and explaining things to them. So it was constantly cycling in. We had hundreds of people doing that. And in the meantime, we were fighting with the university. Harvey was fought a lot with the administrators about, there's no permit to fill out to do this. So we had, they had to adapt to it and fought with that. And this is where I'm a little unclear, but I want to focus on this one part. We did end up having to take them down. One got torn down, one got taken down. So one we actually took down ourselves, as we were told to. So this, I've been involved in lots of different movements and guerrilla theater. This was the most exciting and successful guerrilla theater I'd ever been involved in. So they told us that we had to take it down, I think by noon. And at noon, the chancellor, Everhart, was going to speak on the steps of Fullinger Auditorium, which nobody ever spoke there. He was going to speak about South Africa. So what we did is we held this huge protest. We had hundreds of people. There's a bunch of pictures here I can pass around and show people. And we had some people dressed as the South African police, and the rest of us protested, and they were attacking us and tearing down the shanties, and people were fighting back. So it was this huge, and there was hundreds of people.
But there were also students dressed as politicians with briefcases full of fake money pass out to the South African police.
So before noon, we had torn down everything, and everybody was laying dead on the quad. And the chancellor came out to speak and did not alter his speech one bit. He's like, thank you for coming out today. There's like 300 people. And of course we went on and we rebuilt it and did it in other places and we moved it around and stuff like that.
I would like to say that specifically that one of the shanty towns that we built, the rallying cry was bring wood and
yeah.
And one of the shanty towns was torn down specifically because, as it is now, it was Mom's Day weekend.
Yeah. Oh.
And they did not care for, that cluttering up.
Isn't that when they knocked? Isn't that when they came through and knocked
it
down at midnight?
Well, actually, they did it exactly in the, ironically enough, not, they didn't understand the irony of it, but they did it at about 4 a.m.
Okay.
And they did it in exactly the same way that many houses of South Africans were torn down and bulldozed. So, and it was frightening for the people who were there because this was the one that was done without any warning. Now, granted, we were not in any of the same kind of peril that folks in South Africa were, but the fact that this was done in a sort of secretive manner and for the specific reason to beautify, a la Lady Bird Johnson, to beautify the area. The irony was not lost on us, although it was lost on them. That was the second shanty that was torn down, and they had thought perhaps that it was going to happen without any publicity, but a couple of people quickly called the radio and television stations, and so they were able to come out and videotape that and put it on the news. And so then that's the only way we're actually able to get the third shanty town up, was there was a little shamefacedness about that.
Well, there were threats as well.
Yeah. Were there?
Oh yeah, I threatened repeatedly.
Oh, your threats? Yes.
To take them to Danville to see Judge Baker, because they just blatantly told me, the last one that we built, they blatantly told me that the administration didn't want it there. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, what's the campus for if it's not for expression of ideas? So I remember we had the TV cameras waiting and we negotiated all day and I asked for half the quad because I talked to you all and they said we don't need that. But I asked for half the quad and they thought by cutting us down to the like a quarter that they were restricting us and it was more than what we needed. And then they tried to tell us there are too many there. You don't need that. They tried to lay all kind of conditions and
rules.
But finally the last one, I remember they said they had to be portable, so we lifted them up for them, and it was so portable we even moved it, and then moved it back for some event. But the last one went up after they knocked the one down, and it was up for weeks.
This is why we need to get together, because 30 years later, I didn't remember all the details.
Well, that's because you all just kind of, you all were busy. You sent me to the meeting to do the negotiating, and everybody was out there waiting, but that was one of the first official victories after the arrest and everything. We kind of boxed them in.
You know, and that was a really important thing to do, because a broader legal issue that kept cropping up was the ability of people to use the quad and other university locations to speak impromptu and to organize a group of people to go and do that. And they kept saying to us, right, so I don't know who you were dealing with, but Yuki Llewellyn was one of the administrators who demanded a permit to get in front of the alma mater statue to demonstrate or to speak. And I mean, that is such a central place for a lot of speech. So anyway, that was one issue that kept coming up and required some confrontation, which was reasonable. It wasn't, ugly. It was aggressive at times, but it, it was reasoned.
Well, I'll wrap up my section and pass it on to Lisa. So I guess, to sum up, the Chinatowns was a hugely effective political tool for us. It communicated our message to the masses. We educated our members. We had to strategize and plan because we were there 24 hours a day. And it really solidified the core group. And then at the end of it, it taught us, educated us how hard it was to get rid of a bunch of pallets and wood that was spray painted with political slogans. It was really hard to get rid of.
That's the end of your story.
We're going to store it in somebody's house for a while and we had a movie. Sometimes something like that, I think.
Probably.
So I'm not quite sure. Is there anything in specific you would like me to speak about? Okay. Well, so here's the thing. There is a picture in the archives of me being arrested and being led out of the Board of Trustees meeting, and that was also being filmed by Channel 3 News at the time. And my mother was just coming home from bringing my grandfather home to live with us. And she sat him down in the living room and went out to get his suitcases out of the car and turned on the news, and there I am. And so he's yelling like a maniac for her to come rushing in, and she's thinking, what, there's a car accident, what's going on? And finally he saw that. But he saw the film version of this, and That was what it was. What came full circle for me, the understanding of the idea, because my grandfather's phrase was always, a fella's got to help a fella out. And he would say that to us about various and sundry things. And I think maybe 15 years later was when I actually began to understand, oh, this is what we're talking about, not just on a small scale betwixt me and you, but also on a larger global scale, that in order for my life to have meaning or more meaning, and that's one of the reasons I'm a teacher now, but in order for my life to have meaning, part of that meaning comes from educating myself about the world around me, making sure that I am connected to the world around me in a visceral way, and then doing what I can to leave the world a better place in whatever sense that means when I'm gone. And so all of this was happening for me at the time, subconsciously, of course, as a 21-year-old. It was happening for me as I was learning to do this work, not just doing this work, but learning to do this work, learning to be a spokesperson, learning to work in a horizontal organization, for the most part, if you will, and learning that whatever small sacrifices I make are nothing compared to what those who are really on the front lines of whatever is happening for them, think Syrian refugees right now. Mm-hmm. So that was just sort of all the stuff that was going on for me. I think one of the reasons I ended up becoming a spokesperson for the group was because my very first action was to go to Springfield with, I don't know if it was you or Teresa Donnelly and Lawrence James, and I wore a
Grim Reaper
outfit, and I read a statement outside the Machota Peace meeting, and apparently I did that very well because it ended up making it on the news, and they said, there's going to be one of our spokespersons. And then now I have an acting career. So there you go. But I had to learn very much what it meant that it was not a top-down, here, let me help you poor people do your thing, right? It was very much, I had to learn from folks in South Africa, from folks who have been activists for a very long time, what my actual place was in the movement. And my actual place is not to be a spokesperson for those people who could speak for themselves, but to be a spokesperson for my part of what I could do as a student at the University of Illinois. And the call for divestment was, it really was a nationwide movement. And our group ended up, you know, pre-cell phone, pre-internet, but we ended up doing a lot of interaction with folks from California, from folks from Michigan, folks from Yale University, different conferences all of, I'm sorry?
Yes.
Different conferences all across the country that we attended, and that helped to build and solidify this movement, which is what I also think took, if we're speaking specifically about the University of Illinois, I think it took the administration here a little bit by surprise, because perhaps they thought it was, that they had to come to the recognition that we were very well trained and very intelligent, and that we were planners and thinkers, and that we were not just a bunch of people running around trying to feel something, but that we were actually very, very disciplined in working towards a goal, right? And that goal was divestment on the short-term scale, and the long-term scale was, of course, freeing Nelson Mandela and then the death of apartheid in South Africa. So anyway, I learned a lot about being an activist. I carried that work forward. There are many tales we can tell. I can talk about the fact that I would attend my anthropology classes, and there was a professor who's retired now, so I don't think he minds me telling the story, that lent us a university car that belonged to the anthropology department, which we carried a lot of wood in. I want to leave that. Here's the keys to the station wagon. Go ahead and take it. Most folks in the anthropology department, most folks, now most were solidly behind us, and they helped us we talked very much about the idea of you get an education in the class, a particular type of education in the classroom, but you also get a very particular type of education outside of the classroom. And so I had teachers who were very good at helping me figure out how and when I was going to get my assignments done, because, you know, it ran the gamut from staying up till 2 or 3 or 5 or 6, oh, and then going to class, oh, and then going out to check in what was going on at the shantytown, actually having class outside and asking the teacher to excuse me because there were a bunch of young fraternity boys coming over and I had to go over and have a little chat with them at the shanty and I would be back with my assignment later, et cetera, et cetera. So all those kinds of things were happening, and it was exciting, it was terrifying in many ways, because I was a nerd and I was a good girl, and I, you know, nobody in my, this hadn't happened for anybody in my family. Little did I know that I was going to be a part of something that 30 years later would, you know, spark interest. And I mean, there's student movement now regarding tuition and the budget, and they are actually referencing this movement.
Well, and they tried to get the university to invest up coal.
Yes,
and
they did.
The UC Senate approved that this week, so excited about that.
So anyway, that's fine. Oh,
do you all do this now?
No, we'll do it afterwards.
Do it later.
We're going to go through all of us and then do that. So
hold on to that.
I will. I shall.
Okay. I'm just going to acknowledge that, you know, you heard my story, so I'm kind of being...
Which is awesome.
Well, but I mean, I'm trying to help everyone facilitate that. And I see a lot of people in the audience who got arrested and built shanties. And what I really want to talk about with folks is, like, how very special all of these people were and how brilliant they were. Like Steve Apothecary.
Oh,
and, God. You know, and other folks. Charlie Smythe. We were hoping Charlie would be here. You know, that was my... So our own... folks, I think for me, so there was this retreat that they had, okay, and it was sort of a faux retreat where the trustees came and we talked about divestment.
Was it at Allerton?
It was at Allerton, okay, and so I have information about that. And it was very stressful for me because they picked students to come, and then because I was a Student Government Association president, they picked me. And so I really had to educate myself, and Jeff and Lisa actually came with me. So I get to pick folks to come with me, and it was a bit of a setup, and we knew it was a setup a little bit. Mm-hmm. And they brought in the president of the University of Virginia. Do you remember that, Robert O'Neill? Because he was sort of the expert on this, okay? And he gave a speech, and they were supposed to let us see what he was going to talk about before he spoke, and they didn't. And so we were, you know, all this prep work, and they knew, we knew that it wasn't going to really, the outcome was going to be, it wasn't going to amount to anything. The other piece that, that I would say about it that I think it would probably be of interest to folks is the fact that all the trustees, and you don't realize this, were meeting with me privately, okay? Like they would come, like the Nina Shepherd, remember Nina, another folk, Susan Gravenhorst, and they would meet with me and be like, what can you, and I'd be like, no, this is what folks are going to do, and this is what we're here to do.
You can't hide, we charge you with genocide.
And so, and I'd be like, no, the students were elected, and this is what they're you have to respect people's right to do that. And folks weren't at this meeting, but there was a Board of Trustees meeting at the Rockford campus, where, again, Logan was kind of putting up to folks, and it was the most embarrassing public meeting I've ever been in. And were any of you there? When Dean Madden talked to him about, well, I don't even want to say it out loud, what he said. It was horrible. It was like, well, your tribe wants to do this, honestly, and my tribe wants to do this, it was at a Board of Trustees meeting, and it was...
Al Logan was the only African-American
on the Board of Trustees.
And he was the only one. He brought this vote up,
every time.
Meeting after meeting for years.
And it was at the Rockford campus, and there weren't a lot of folks there, and it was...
Wow.
It was... I mean, it was awful. And so I guess that for that I want people to really understand like how much dedication and how much education really went into it. And if you have time to look over there, I remember I got the packet from the Board of Trustees, which came to me right away, and we were waiting for it. And this is sort of our response to what we think about the request to divest, okay? And they have a whole bunch of articles. And then immediately I took it to Steve and Charlie and other folks, and they started writing a response, and we had it bound in the exact same cover, except it had the alma mater and change, the divest now, it's over here. So, it's really pretty powerful, just how educated and thoughtful and well thought out it was. And I think that's really what I want to convey to folks, that it was, I felt really, even at the time, I felt really privileged to be around all the folks involved in that, and I didn't take that for granted at all. And you know, it caused me, I never will forget someone coming to my office and saying really homophobic things to Larry, really terrible things, and me kicking that person out of the office and saying never come back again. And I thought, you know, like, I'd like to think that I would have done that, but what I'm trying to say is how much it just totally, all this changed your life about how you kind of treat individuals. And
I think your story is sort of the epitome of what we talk about in terms of the university being a place where one is supposed to come into one's own in terms of becoming a real thinker and creating your own point of view that may be influenced by but isn't just regurgitated tablet from somewhere else.
Right.
And you came from a particularly small community, and I have to say, you to me, you epitomize what a good politician, we have so few examples these days, is probably supposed to be, which is someone who is facilitating folks in her community, facilitating, doing what you can to help folks do what succeed at what they want to do. And I think also it was a little bit easier for us in some ways because we knew where we stood and everyone else knew where we stood. There was an expectation from the university for you to be, because you were president of student government, there was an expectation that you would be politic.
Right.
And so I think that was a puzzle to them, your own
person.
Student government had been mostly fraternity and sorority run for many, many years until this slate came in.
Right.
So.
Which I was not, though. Like, that was sort of the outlier. Yeah. So the person
you weren't off-center or you weren't.
Well, yeah, and I wasn't. So, but
which already,
I'll just say that. The other piece was that I always find it fascinating when we talked, Bryan, that people really thought that people were going to be removed from campus, because I never thought that would happen. Through your student discipline process. And that was my perception of it. And it might have been naive, but I felt like, you had such a defense lined up, everybody here did. I believed in the, I am one of those administrators now, so I know that they were, and I got into it with them too. I said, I don't report to you, I'm going to go, not agree with paying University of Illinois champagne, paying for residence halls at University of Chicago, because that happened the year before all this happened. And I feel like I thought they were going to do the right thing, because I think deep down they wouldn't probably say this, but they believe you were doing the right thing.
Right.
I don't mean that. I know that, like that, I don't know.
The letters that we got.
The university
they
has never
really,
done the right thing.
Well, I get it.
They really made us think the letters of communication we got from them were really were kind of threatening.
Then
I think they were really surprised when we would show up to the disciplinary hearings with our lawyers. And so they thought, oh, okay, so these aren't just students who are going to cower and say, please don't kick me out. We each stood up, we had a prepared statement, we could argue with clarity and, multisyllabic words, and so they were taken aback by that also.
But the The one downside of all that is they really revamped the disciplinary.
Yeah, they made it much.
And now a lawyer can do nothing but whisper in the client's
ear. Yeah.
Cannot speak at all.
Yeah.
And it came out of these hearings.
Yeah. And let me, before I turn over to Bryan, let me just set the stage for what happened. So we had a big rally. At the same time, we had the Shanty Towns. We had a huge rally on the quad. And our plan was, the board was meeting the next day. We knew they already were in town. They stayed at the Union Hotel. We knew they were going to be there. So we had about 1,000 people on the quad. And then afterwards, and there's some more pictures we can pass out. We stormed the South Lounge of the Union, and we occupied it. And we thought that was going to be the flashpoint.
We thought that was it.
And they let us stay.
Yeah.
And they let us stay all night long. And we were like, what do we do now? Like, it wasn't really our plan. We thought that would be the flashpoint. So then we came up with, since we were up all night, that we were going to go into the board meeting, and there's a copy of it here. We had a resolution that we said, this is the resolution we want you to vote on.
Right.
And we had a wave of three people that went in and did it. Then they got pulled out. Then we had another wave of people that went in. Ended up that 60 people got arrested. And then there was hundreds more that were in the hallway that probably should have been arrested because we were, hammering things. And then the outcome of that, well, we shut the board meeting down. They hauled us out. There's a really great picture. There was a guy, that's not a great picture. That's a horrible picture. But we used to call this one cop our cop because he was the rookie who was assigned to us. And he's in a lot of the photos.
And he was about our age.
He was about our age. And he's now the chief of police at the U of I. So he's in a bunch of the pictures in here, but he was always out there. But the outcome of this was that we had 60 people arrested, mostly students, undergrad, grad, and then some community members. And what happened is that everybody faced charges, criminal charges, as well as disciplinary charges. Every grad school had their own disciplinary system, and the undergrads had a system. So that's why we had 7 lawyers, and we had just an insane amount of legal defense stuff that went on. And we raised a lot of money and had some great concerts.
Yeah.
I'll turn it over to you now.
I don't think I have anything more to say other than, just the observation that working on this cases was a really good, first step toward the other things that happened years later. The issues that arose from this case about speech kind of recur on this campus. And, as Belden Fields found out, he held up a sign one day in the Union and got arrested, violating the no signs in the air of the Union. So it was good. It was good. It was an honor and a pleasure.
Remember your question.
So I guess we're going to open up to questions now, if that's... Oh, wait. Before we do, I just wanted to say, so looking at lessons of the movement, and trying to go back through all this stuff and looking through these things. I think the lessons were that students and the community can have an impact on the U of I through organizing and direct action. We did have an impact. Even though we didn't really win complete divestment, we did accomplish a lot. We sent a signal to those struggling for freedom in South Africa that we were part of the movement, part of an international movement. We put hundreds of people in motion here. We had, as Rhonda tells, we touched hundreds of people who, to this day, this impacts their lives. They remember what happened. It shaped their careers and what they do. We were often told of the dangers of divestment. One of the big, big things that the university would always say is, you can't open up the Pandora's box. Once you open up the Pandora's box, everybody will want divestment from everything. And we advocated socially responsible investments back then. We had people that came from Calvert. This was early stuff in social responsible investing. We had them come. And today, investments are so much more complicated than they were back then. Actually, even though there was nothing online, it was relatively simple. Now it's difficult. And I still saw just in the paper today around the coal stuff, around the BDS movement, they still talk about the Pandora's box. We can't do this. We can't have morals in our investments because everybody will want to have their say. So
everybody
will
want to have morals.
So I wanted to open it up. So Grant had
questions.
So one of the things that was a common theme was this kind of university versus community interest. You know, when I was starting to volunteer and do social justice stuff, and you mentioned that the kid, shit, I'm embarrassed now.
Oh my God. Sorry, y'all. Thanks, Grant.
So I wanted to ask, what types of ways, like what were your strategy to engage the community in a meaningful level, besides getting folks to say, oh, that's just a university, you know, campaign?
Well, we were working nonstop. I remember us meeting with, we went to the Urban League.
We went to the Urban League. I went back to Centennial, which was my high school. Myself and Joe Moe, we went there. We spoke at history classes. We went to my mother's church, Salem Baptist Church. Those are three things I can remember right now. And there were already, being both a community member, having grown up here, and then also a university student, there was a recognition. I mean, I felt it much more then than I do now. Then there was, I think the lines between the university and the town were much blurrier. And as a child, I spent a lot of time on campus, and it felt like the campus is part of my community. Right now, it feels much more segregated.
Yeah, sure.
Even though I work at the university, when I walk across campus, I feel a disconnect from being a member. But I think that there was much more fluidity then. And a lot of our members of the DNC, even though we were an RSO, we had folks ex officio or whatever, but they were members and they would attend our events. And so they were community members already involved in the group.
Jenny Putman, who was, I thought was going to be here tonight, but she was on the county board for many, many years then. She was actually one of the people arrested. Siva Popker, who was the head of the community recycling center,
yeah,
and was the godfather of all information on divestment.
Oh, yeah. Well, you have to think about the fact that this started in 1977, mm-hmm. So some of the folks, say, in the community working or in grad school or part-time grad students and some other things, so that was part of it, too. We had that benefit.
And the divestment movement wasn't just limited to universities. It was happened all over the country. It was happening in unions. It was happening, like the Urban League was a big thing nationwide. They were really in support of it. And when we met with them, we had a press conference with them here. I mean, that's just a small sampling of stuff. I mean, we were working round the clock. I mean, we had you know, a good core of probably 70 to 100 people who would be doing stuff on a weekly or daily basis.
And so I think to also answer your question is, we did have a recognition that we wanted it not to be wanted to be more than just a university student effort. We wanted it to be a whole community effort. And to that end, when we were planning our events, we made sure to include the larger community, both in either in the planning of the event or, you know, in questions surrounding what is positive or negative for them about being able to attend it or whatever. Mm-hmm. And then, so we made sure that reaching out to the community was one of the tenets of how we wanted to work on this.
I found some of the documents, I found something, it was a speaker list from a rally. Mm-hmm. I think we had 30 people.
Damn.
The idea was like we were going a little overboard, trying to have everybody in on it. And the plan was that they'd be really short, but I don't think it was. Other comments, questions?
I just wanted to mention, because I didn't remember a lot of this until you started talking about it. So I worked at the Daily Illini during that time, and I remember this, what we would sit around, we lived in the basement of Illini Hall, and we lived there, and we talked about how we felt at the time that the generations before us thought, well, these kids have nothing to complain about. They have no issues to really be, they're not really feeling any hurt or anything. And when you started to see this movement happen, you could tell this was very sincere. People were very concerned that money was supporting this system, and it was so wrong that it wasn't just, oh, kids with nothing better to do, you know, looking for a cause to be chic. They really were committed. And I wanted to say that it made the Daily Illini a better student paper because we really wanted to get it right. We wanted to cover it accurately. And there are a lot of really good people who came out of there pursuing journalism because of what happened and what they were doing and so committed to it. People who went on to the Tribune and the Miami Herald and Boston Sun and into social services and government to try to be different. And so I just wanted to say, you inspired a lot of other people to get right as well. So I just want to throw that out there.
Well, exactly. Back then, the DI was a credible alternative to the News Gazette. I mean, it was a daily paper that had a huge circulation, and there was, you know, there was a lot of coverage in there.
So just a huge shout out for what you guys did, and I was just wondering whether you're ready to settle up and do it again. Because, I mean, news from the trenches, of course, apartheid didn't die. It's still alive and well, and next week there's an Israeli apartheid week. On the campus, and I certainly want to invite you, the panel. I'm teaching a course this year called Global Apartheid, which is looking at, you know, anti-Arab racism, anti-Muslim. So, and one of the facts of surviving the apartheid, the Holocaust, is that it was actually a very useful way to see the world. So that's the one part of it. I think that your story is very powerful, and I think one of the things that events like this can do is to dismiss the notion that apartheid is dead. Mm-hmm. I think it is very powerful to resuscitate. I mean, that old form of anti-South African apartheid, which is maybe, you know, I don't know, the gold standard of racial segregation, all right, seems to now mutate. And this is the hydra-headed monster that has mutated and, as you mentioned, more segregated. There's a lot of echoes I see in the landscape here after being 15, 16 years. So I think that's one of the key things that, and just a shout out to Anka and the Urbana Library. So we just had a conference with Texan Espert, who unfortunately couldn't be here, but that seems to me a next logical kind of event to share. So, well, not to continue, but I think the main point is that I think that this generation needs to hear the strategies and tactics and experiences. I don't know if you followed at the University of Cape Town campus. I mean, it's gotten so upside down, they even had to construct their own shack on that campus in South Africa, which is how enclaved it's become, and it's been torched and so forth. So the strategy of occupying public space, holding their ground, symbolizing, and the material aspects of it, I think is quite key. So your question about the lessons learned, I think, is perhaps somewhat modest. I think there's the other part about it is the need for continued international solidarity, which this movement, I think, I'm working with activists on eviction in housing in Chicago and Cape Town, and we're kind of rethinking about how to stay in touch despite all of the technology and learning the lesson. So it's a long way of getting around saying I think that your story is exceptionally powerful. I think it needs to get out to this generation now. I think this idea of apartheid is alive and well, or maybe the ghost is coming back to haunt in most bizarre forms. European apartheid is on the rise, right, as is Middle Eastern apartheid. So I think the divestment campaign is much more needed now than ever before. I think the Israeli BDS lost, there was just a Haaretz had in Israel for the first time, an anti-BDS program, which is an indication of how successful it's becoming. And of course the coal divestment movement. So anyway, I could go on, and I just think that you need to saddle up and ride again away from the sunset. So
get the band back.
Reunion tour.
Yeah. Can you go speak to Alan
Hall?
That is definitely.
No, for sure. I think, I mean, all of them. With the Archaean, we're hoping to get your material to another audience, particularly with African American, the African Students Organization. I think one of the biggest myths we fight in now is the overestimated demise of the country.
Well, you mentioned Prexy Nesbitt, and Krexy was and is an amazing freedom fighter. He came to many of our rallies, taught us, inspired us. There's some pictures of him. He was part of the events, and he was brought in as a speaker a lot. And I'm glad he's still... I looked him up just the other day, and I was looking for him.
He's still in the trenches, this.
Great.
This is kind of more, less like amazingly inspirational, but minutia. I'm just curious, when you have a core of like 75 to 100 people, how do you have any sort of handle on that or direction? I mean, I know it's a goal, but do you have like subgroups and let them run with it? Like how did you even manage that?
I had a notebook. Well, the one we had no email.
We had no
cell phones. Most people didn't even have answering machines.
So how did you text?
With chalk and leaflets.
We were out all the time. You were with someone or around someone or going to meet someone all the time.
They're talking about
decision. Right.
We had
decision making.
We had huge meetings. Uh-huh. Like once a week or so.
They just go all night long. I mean,
But we had committees. We definitely had a committee structure. I was one of the coordinators. There was so many heads and so many hands that you couldn't know everything that was going on. I mean, when the legal defense stuff came up, that was there. We had people who were in charge of making posters and doing leaflets. We'd have an event. We moved to, after the big stuff in the spring, we moved to focus. The Board of Trustees were elected back then, and we moved to focus on elections of Board of Trustees members. And there was even, and too bad Jenny isn't here. Jenny got us credentials to go to the Democratic convention in Springfield.
Yes.
And this is the year that the LaRouches took over the Democratic Party. Yes. So Lyndon LaRouche was a cult leader, and he had snuck in with these white American sounding names and kicked out people like Oriello Puchinsky and other people. And so the Democrats were in disarray, so they had their convention at a union hall. We were there just to bring up the issue of divestment because the trustees were selected, and the LaRouches come marching up with violins, playing the Battle Hymn of the Republic, and our people got tossed out of the, even though we had conventions, we got tossed out. That was just one example. We had people working on electoral strategy. So we had lots of committee structure, and there were lots of phone calls. I found a notebook of mine with phone numbers.
At one point we had daily meetings, but when the heat was ramping up, before the chanties and the occupation, we would have weekly meetings. But even in between that, there were phone calls, there was a committee meeting here, committee meeting there, information passed formally and informally amongst each other. The old standby of the phone tree. I know that the morning that the U of I came at 4 a.m. to tear the shanties down, I was told after, because people got called, I slept through that because I was so tired. They tried for 20 minutes to wake me up, and they said, we're just going to go and take care of it, you know, without it. So, you know, my two roommates then, Lucy and Jenny, they had to go and be there and take care of it anyway. But so there was a lot of phone calling. There was a lot of small actions being planned, major events being planned, information being given. And then after all those 60 people got arrested, so the group grew almost exponentially overnight because we had to deal with all of these people who were a part of this moment.
And not all those were core people either.
And not they were. Many of them were not core people. Many of them were like, "Hey, there's a thing going on, and I want to be a part of it. This is fun, and my blood is up, and you know." And now they have no idea what to say and what to do, but we still had to take care of them, you know. So it was just constant communication.
It was constant, and Jeff and I were talking, not to go too much into it, but there was strife too within, there was a lot of strife about like what's
come on.
And so, but there was some fun stuff too. There was a lot of good music, and you know, there was
great card parties, dance parties,
It was kind of like hanging with the cool kids.
Yeah, pretty much.
That's what I feel like, just thinking about it.
I mean, we probably weren't the most democratic. because there was so much going on that was, I mean, literally some of us were there.
No, you really were very democratic.
Well, we tried to be.
You were. I was always impressed by how
the group would talk things out.
Yeah, the group, because I would refer to somebody as the head and they go, no, there's no head to this. No, you were very democratic.
So idealistic.
Since you both are still in higher ed, I want to know if you see a significant change in the way universities are allowing, quote unquote, these types of things. For example, even building of new universities now, they're not even including quads anymore.
Really?
Yeah, it's a way to just get rid of a social meeting place, which in turn will quiet the
campus.
That's
just sad. Well, administrations in general have gotten smarter about how to deal with things, just as they got smart from this the 60s on in terms of how to deal with things. So they've gotten smarter in terms of how to nip things in the bud, how to redirect things, what the particular speech is you're supposed to speak. I remember was reading some of those articles you had just put over there, and some of the things that the trustees literally put in print were awful, and that you would never say, we're putting for instance, one of the trustees said, well, we're putting this aside now. We have to deal with important stuff, things you would never think to say now. So they have definitely gotten smarter at dealing with protest movements.
And PR.
How they present themselves to the public. Yeah.
So I'm an associate dean of students, so I'm sort of on the in the mix of all of it. And so I feel like, and I'm a low level, like I'm a mid manager, okay? So I feel like my job is to make sure that students have the information and nobody's stepping in their way and they're staying safe. And so one of the things that I did that Latino students took over Swanland Administration Building. I don't know if you remember that. Okay.
1992.
Or 93 or 94.
Well, they got all the
information. They got and there's chief stuff and other things. Yeah. But like I stayed in. So one of my jobs was to stay in the Student Services Building all night and watch. Really? The police to make sure they didn't take, like, we were there to, I was there to watch.
Sure the police
didn't do other, what they shouldn't do. Like, mm-hmm. And so, like, and there have been times when I've met with chief folks who wanted to march to the football stadium or to march down the streets and other things. And we get the police together and we are trying to do everything we can to allow folks to do what they want to do and be safe. And so, I find, from my perspective now, people want to march from, Henry to the alma mater to the Swanland and complain. We're just there to watch and make sure that they're safe and allow people that freedom of speech. Now, then it goes to, we could argue about that a lot because the freedom of speech is freedom of speech for people to still wear their chief shirts and say things, you know what I mean? And so that's sort of the hard part. So how do you kind of educate people and do some other things? But, it's hard. But what I feel like I'm trying to do in my role is to help students see that you can do whatever you want to do here. And I'll help you try to be successful at that. And don't try to do what you think the administration wants. Mm-hmm. Okay? And that's hard for them to, and I can't, because I have my job, so I have to kind of push, and I can't do it for them. Okay? And that's what the issue, some folks, Lisa talks about, like, people don't come on the campus. So you think about, like, a lot of these, and I have a 14 and a 17-year-old, or 15 now, and a 17-year-old, and they're so different in kind of how even I've raised them. You protect them. You you're, you have to kind of know where they're at. I try to get them to go out and do independent things, but all the stuff at school, you know, all these things, you know, so they kind of travel in packs and nobody comes down to campus. I mean,
they don't.
Y'all came down to campus because their parents just don't let them travel without being in their sight. So how do you then, now they're here and they're all alone, like how do we, you know, help them be safe and be successful and but not be safe and do stuff that's out of their comfort zone and so that's but I think we do better at protest. We don't make people fill out the safe
forms.
But we're not perfect. Like there was the wall that folks built a couple of years ago and for the Palestine, and there was issue with that, and it got larger. And then I think we were mostly concerned about safety at that point too, because it was really tall and some other things. So it's not perfect, but how do you, you know?
Well, as Harvey said, they did, the student code was rewritten, the Code of Public Affairs, after the Vietnam protests and after our protests.
Thanks a lot.
And this is a small aside about when we did the protest. We always tried to be respectful of the workers, especially the workers in the union. And there was one of, I can't remember his name now, I think his name was Herb, but for years, whenever he saw me at a protest, like, you guys do good protests. You take care of business, you know what you're doing. Like, we didn't mess, you know, we focused on the board, we didn't try to mess everything up.
And but so that's part of the philosophy is that when you're working for social justice, you're not just working for one group of social justice, you're working for the ideal of social justice, which is for everybody. So I don't, you know, I had an issue, I know a lot of people did, and I have an issue with the woman who shimmied up a flagpole and took down the Confederate flag because an African-American worker had to go and put that sucker back up. So we have to think about people in all different strata. Because being at the university, whether you are poor, I was the first person in my family to go to university, even if you are poor, you're still in a privileged place. So what do you do with that privilege? You know, first of all, you recognize it, and then what do you do with it?
Okay, could you talk about like the victory? Did it feel like the win you were looking for? Did the university present it as like, oh, we're amazing?
They snuck
like,
in very after we, after they had hoped that the last protester had graduated. They snuck it in.
Well, what was the internationally the movement? The
Bishop Tutu had to curse Ronald Reagan. Let's put it that way. Bishop Desmond Tutu had to curse Ronald Reagan after the Congress did one more. I think Congress passed it and Reagan vetoed it.
What was happening, so Capitol had found a way around this. Mm-hmm. So what we had focused on was, you know, IBM provides the, you know, technology to keep the passbooks that, you know, keep apartheid in place. GM provided, you know, tanks to do this stuff. And the U of I had huge investments in GM and IBM. So this thing, which was called fake disinvestment, came up, which was basically IBM and GM sold their subsidiaries to South Africans, and then it was like, oh, this is no longer part of the portfolio you're talking about. So 21 million shrunk to 3.3 million, and they took out IBM and GM. And this all happened, and that was a much more complicated argument. So this thing happened in January. I was actually on the way back from Zambia.
Yeah.
Like, I had missed the vote. Like, there was very few of us even at the meeting. From when it happened, we didn't know what was happening, and then the core was like, we lost. We got to fight harder, and the majority were like throwing their hats up and celebrating.
Yeah.
And that was essentially the end of the movement. And then we tried to segue. We'd always said fight racism at home and abroad, and which we did during the movement. But then everybody kind of dissipated, and we tried to do anti-racism work. I tried to work with people. We worked with the Harold Washington campaign in Chicago, then the Jesse Jackson campaign, but that went from this to, you know, to this.
Yeah.
I mean, the Coalition Against Apartheid survived. They were very small. They had some activity over the next few years, but it was really a perception. It was a good PR move. It was exactly it stopped the movement, and so I felt that.
And they knew it was little to no risk to them to do what they did. But that it would, I think they knew exactly what was going to happen, is that the majority of folks who were not deeply aware of all the complexity of the issues would throw their hats in the air, and they would be okay while they could, you know, keep their true investment.
But you all won on other levels.
Yes.
If you remember, the university was threatening expulsions and suspensions and all types of things through the disciplinary system. Nobody got expelled. Bryan and I were trying to figure out, we think the most serious consequence may have just been a letter of reprimand in that respect. In the criminal part of the whole thing, only three people had to go to trial, and they ended up getting court supervision, but we were able to get the charges dismissed just because the system was going to collapse. If you remember the first pretrial, when they had all 60 people there, not occupying, but waiting to be called in out on the floor, and the powers that be said, we can't continue to bring all these people in to court. So in addition to all the PR that we got for the cause, individually we were able to make the university unball their fist after they just awful threats. I can remember the law school, we had one law student in the group who's now a judge.
Who's that?
Freitag. Robert Freitag is now a judge in McLean County. But the university, just the law school was over there just ignoring his First Amendment rights. They acted like he had no right to speak at all, and I was just like shocked that the law school would take this attitude. So there were victories.
Yes, no, I don't want to, there weren't victories. Go ahead,
Marshall. The goal of movement is not to get the original word in MS. The goal was to overthrow apartheid in South Africa. So that was the victory.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Also, the goal, and I think this is relevant to BDS today, I mean, it seemed to me at the time, the brass ring as far as the United States was concerned was getting Congress to pass sanctions and override Reagan's veto, which is what all this ferment was building towards. So that happened too. If you look at the history of how people in the elite, in South Africa were talking to each other about the world, it was when Congress passed the sanctions against South Africa over Reagan's veto, and the effect that that was having on U.S. corporations and the financial market, the people in the elite in South Africa said, okay, game's up, we need to start negotiating. So that's a victory. Those are victories. And it's to me, it's a tactic, and it's important not to lose sight of the larger goal that the tactic is building for. It's easy to get consumed with the local, the local struggle that at the expense of the broader thing that this is feeding into. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a risk of all these movements. It's a tremendously powerful tactic to be able to say, okay, here's our local organizing work. This is something that we can do locally.
May I please but the have goal your is, the Urbana Free Library will close in 30 minutes.
So,
patrons who wish to apply for or renew library cards.
In terms of lessons today, let's keep that in mind all the time for, like, you know, BDS on Israel and Palestine. The goal is to change the situation in Palestinians, not to, you know, particular detail.
Sure, but in January of 1986, we didn't see apartheid ending at that point. We didn't see this stuff. At that point, we felt, you know, I mean, I'm just talking about the core. I mean, I understand completely. I mean, the fact that we put people in motion for the rest of their lives
I actually disagree with you a bit, because I do think that it was that particular goal, and I think it's good for us to be able to say, no, we did not get that goal, not because it isn't just about us feeling all good and flowery. It's about us learning life lessons that we then continue to take into whatever struggles we move into next. So I think it is important, and I also think, you know, that whole bumper sticker thing about think globally, act locally, I mean, one, absolutely it makes sense, but it's also the idea of, you know, the I didn't want to just, of course I wanted to divest because I wanted to have an effect, hopefully, somewhere on something that's going on in South Africa. But I'm also not, I have no illusions about the importance of my particular self in this vast movement, right? That I am not the particular shining beacon that anyone should be looking towards. I'm a person who's supposed to be working towards something like everybody else is working towards something. And part of life is learning how and when to let go of something, when to continue to pursue something, et cetera, et cetera. I think that as a young person, the particular lesson I learned, it did give me some cynicism, yes, but you know, I still had, the cynicism wasn't enough that I didn't continue doing the work, you know. But what it also did was it taught me, oh, timing is incredibly important when you are working with large bureaucratic structures because their boat, you know, their boat is going to take a long time to make that turn and I have to continue to struggle, but I also have to have patience in some way. So the fact that they did whatever they did, that little bit of what they did, I was less, put it this way, Ivan Berry got up and made a speech, and we were aghast that this thing happened, this weird thing happened after some of us were graduated and we were scattered. But what I was also more interested in was that I was politicized, other people were politicized, they took that work out into other areas. And so then that stone in the pond ripple effect is much larger, and that's where I think it actually comes back full circle and agrees with you. It is much larger than the small thing, but I think the significance of the small thing cannot be denied in that. I think it was good for us to know, you know what, they kind of deked us on this. You know, they deked us, but what can we do in the future to make sure that, you know.
I'm gonna go there.
I came in late, but I had a good experience. I was at a meeting of students on campus. It was a small meeting, and they're trying to get a tuition must fall thing going. And of course, it's directly inspired by South Africa. And of course, they showed a video about South Africa, and I just think that I don't know if it's a victory, but I mean the legacy of your struggles and your work. You carry it, and I hope there's a way for these different generations of people who are making those connections across the continents about social justice. I mean, I hope that there's a way for people to make those links, because you know, students do, as you just said, students do graduate and move away, but there's that moment that they're here. When a lot can be done, so I was just struck by the timing of these two events.
I have met with different students over the years who worked on wanted to work in different divestment. There was someone who wanted to do like a prison and like industrial complex divestment, and the danger. The easy thing for us to fall into is, oh, we had this huge rally and this huge thing, and we did all this, and they're like, have a meeting with 10 people. And so you have to pull back and say, you know, you have to look at the conditions now, look at what you can do, look what we accomplished. And, you know, there were different conditions. You could drop out of school and do stuff and work at Coslo's and, you know, protest all day long. You know, not that. Or work at Nature's Table where a bunch of us it was a different environment. So I try to let them know that it's like, hey, just because we did this and at that time in the 80s, which nobody said we could either then, that to, you know, to be conscious.
I know we're short of time, so just two quick comments and then the question. I mean, I think for me, the key significance is the necessity now more than ever, but what you guys demonstrate of this aspect of international solidarity. It's such a vital, particularly anti-racist international solidarity. So I think this movement, if anything, probably should be, you know, framed within that context. I think the other comment, all victories are going to be partial. The 1980s is a very brutal time in Southern African history. One of the key events that I think is also worth mentioning here is the role of Cuba in smashing the apartheid military machine in the 1980s, the battle for Cuba to Carnaval.
and the Cuban and the were literally died in the trenches. So in addition to the financial is the military, and I think this has been actually in some ways the retreat. Of course, finally the fall of the wall is 94, and that sets in motion a whole set of other events. The question I have is this sort of back and forth. So where and how did you stay in touch with South African, you know, struggles, and how did what was happening there influence what you were doing here?
I'll take a stab first. I mean, we did have a lot of African students on campus. There were very few South Africans, but there were a few South Africans. We did, people like Prexy were constantly in touch with the ANC, the African National Congress. We quickly were working with students all across the country. There were groups like, there was a student government group, the USSA, which was a national, and we found out that our student government, which we had pushed, was actually less radical than most of them around the country. We worked with groups like the Progressive Student Network. There was big conferences in Chicago. So there was a lot of going to meetings, and a lot of times ANC people, sometimes PAC people would actually come and travel here. So there was, and then there were national organizations. There was an American Committee on Africa, and another one that we're calling, they tried to do national days. So we would get leaflets and packets of information that was sent to us to pass out about South Africa. So it was by phone, it was by mail, it was by letter.
Literally by letter.
Yeah. So I mean, but we did it because we had no other way to do it.
Hi, I'd like to just briefly discuss the actual collection that Jeff donated, because, and I want to give a shout out to him because I think he's an archivist in his former life. strategizing and organizing. Many of that is well documented in this collection. As he stated earlier, the work of the Divestment movement is just a small, just the tip of the iceberg of what he donated. And there's a lot of everything that he just talked about, like the pamphlets and the documentation from various conferences and committees and that sort of thing is well documented in the collection. So if anyone is interested in really learning how to, it's a great collection of how to organize, how to process, how to, you know, do and go about these activities. So
I'm sensing a book deal, right?
Well, off of that too, I know there's people here who have stuff in their collection that can be added to this. I'm looking at everybody here. I know there's a bunch of videotapes that are somewhere hidden of later stuff, but still important stuff.
Jeff, is the Chiefs things, are they in that?
That's all in the collection too, yeah.
Because I'm going to tell you, and I hate to confess this, but I'm just going to say it, because I used to be one of those people that when the Chief would come out, I would just get so emotional and just love it. It was something that I went to that you were part of, and you passed out a question answer that I kept for you. That turned me around. That turned me around. And I kept that for years and would show it to anybody that would still talk about the Chief as something, because I thought it was so on point. Here's what you think, but think about this. So if that is one of the, I think that's golden. That piece right there is golden.
It's all the flyers, all the pamphlets, all the leaflets, they're all in the collection. I know where you're talking.
You know what I'm talking about? The question answer is golden.
So for all of you passing out leaflets, they do have an impact sometimes. There are some things to look at over there that Anka had. I did pass out some photos. Yeah. There's the Flickr thing to look at, and there's a link to that too. There's some great
and
the News Gazette stuff.
Need to sign if you do have information that you might want to donate, or if you're interested in participating in it.
And most of those News Gazette photos were not run in the paper. These were like the ones they didn't use. So there's some stuff, I'm not trying to remember who some of these people are. Any pious other people might be able to remember who some of these people. And there's, and the Flickr thing, I did find Prexy Nesbitt is mislabeled as Bob Cotter.
Brian, did you? Oh yeah, if you're interested, there's a book written by Francis Boyle, so from law school here, Defending Civil Resistance Under International Law. This is the special edition for pro se protesters part of the legal proceedings from this event are in here.
So pretty casual reading, huh?
Pretty casual.
And the inscription is, to Bryan Savage, my top student. Best regards. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
You move, yeah, we're